Everyone seems to be going NetZero lately, but what does NetZero even mean?
If you had a seesaw, you're bringing the seesaw into balance and arriving at the point of NetZero, which is what the atmosphere calls for.
To properly explain and break down the concept with actual everyday examples that are relevant to you, like how much CO2 is emitted while binging your favorite TV show, I spoke to Emma Stewart, Netflix's sustainability officer. Net zero is basically creating a balance between the greenhouse gases we put in the atmosphere and the CO2 we take out. But it helps to think about it in three R's: reduce, retain, and remove.
You want to reduce your own emissions, ideally in line with what the climate science is calling for, which is our plan.
So, how does a giant company like Netflix, or even an individual like you and I, actually get to net zero? Well, you do it in scopes. The first scope is the easiest to digest. It examines the sorts of fuels you combust. So basically looking at any fuel-based appliance you own, like your stove or your car, and replacing it with an electric one. Netflix calls this step electrifying fuels. For a company like Netflix, its solutions are similar to a consumer's, but at a much larger scale.
For Netflix, the equivalent there is we're electrifying where we can the vehicles that we use for cast and crew, and we are trying where possible to find alternatives to diesel generators.
Now that we've established switching from gas to electricity, we enter scope 2, which focuses on determining how clean the electricity you're using actually is. Netflix calls this optimizing energy. So let's say you switch all your gas appliances to electric. Now you have to take it one step further and make sure the electricity it runs on is coming from renewable energy sources and not fossil fuels. Scope 2 also calls for switching all your lights to LED lighting and purchasing appliances that are energy efficient. At the end of the day, these last two save you energy and money. For big companies, it's more than just replacing its lights though.
The Netflix equivalent to that might be something like, well, with our productions, we try and use local crews. That has, of course, a job generation benefit locally, but it also means we're not flying people in from all parts of the planet to do a job that ideally someone locally would have. Another example is we're using LED lighting wherever possible in our productions. Not only is that 75% more efficient than a conventional light bulb, it doesn't generate waste heat, so then we're not having to cool the space, so we're saving more energy, and talent love it because it doesn't melt your makeup. So it's kind of a win-win.
Obviously, these kinds of changes are easier said than done for people like you and me. It can either be too expensive or simply not accessible. But if you are able to make the switch, every little change helps make an impact. And if you can't do all of it, you can take this information to spread awareness and put pressure on companies and governments that actually have the resources to make positive impacts at a larger scale. And lastly, scope 3 is pretty much everything that happens through third parties and out of your control. Public transportation, waste disposal, purchased goods and services, the food you eat, etc. This is the hardest scope to take control of or even keep track of. Let's take waste disposal for example. You can control how much trash you generate, but you cannot control the amount of diesel burned by the garbage truck that picks up your trash. So at that point, the responsibility is on the city to electrify its fleet of garbage trucks so it can be truly a sustainable system from beginning to end. But that's what's so hard about this scope. You have to do extensive research to know whether the bus you're riding, the food you're eating, or the clothes you're wearing are truly sustainable. And make sure you're purchasing goods from companies that are truly committed to their net zero goals. For Netflix, it's the same. The company tries to work directly with its suppliers to make sure they are hitting their net zero targets before Netflix can subtract them from their scope 3.
We have suppliers who have pretty robust renewable energy targets. We want to feel very sure that they are hitting those targets and that they are retiring those credits before we subtract them from our scope 3. And that's how it should work. We should work with our suppliers to encourage them to reduce their scope 1 and their scope 2. And when they've done that successfully and they can prove it, that reduces our scope 3.
But what about those emissions you simply cannot account for? Well, that's when you decarbonize the rest, according to Emma, meaning going solar, buying green energy through your utilities provider, or buying carbon offsets when you fly.
The Netflix equivalent of that is we have purchased renewable energy credits for 99.9% of our electricity around the world. There was one location where we weren't able to secure those credits. And now we are looking at green tariff programs in the utilities where we don't have them yet operational, and potentially investing directly in renewable energy projects.
Now, if you're wondering what all this has to do with you, it's more than you think. Every day we do things that have a carbon footprint, meaning they cause greenhouse gas emissions. Things like binge watching all of Bridgerton in just one sitting, which, if you're following along, falls under scope 3.
Generally speaking, well below 100 grams of greenhouse gases per viewing hour. So what does that mean? That's equivalent to roughly driving a combustion vehicle a quarter mile. For those who don't own a combustion vehicle or don't operate in miles, I could go about a block and a half here in San Francisco on that amount of carbon.
But we're not telling you this to make you feel guilty or to make you stop watching TV. We need the escapism. It's just to bring awareness to the connection between TV and greenhouse gas emissions. Think about it this way. Behind every hour of TV, there's an entire production with a huge carbon footprint. Sure, there are steps we all can take as individuals. However, the onus is not on you, but on companies like Netflix, which are now realizing the problem and trying to do something about it. Netflix, for one, announced in March that it will become net zero by the end of 2022. Now that sounds ambitious, but according to Emma, the company is making strides.
Well, so we as Netflix are somewhat late in setting a climate target, but we decided we want to ground everything in the science and move at the speed that the science tells us is necessary. And we'll do that by first tackling our own internal emissions and putting them on a diet, as it were, in line with the climate science to keep global warming to no more than 1.5 degrees Celsius, the goals of the Paris Agreement. And then we will invest in the incredible power of nature to retain and remove carbon from the atmosphere. And these can be natural ecosystems like mangroves or forests that have been doing this and stabilizing the climate for millions of years.
Again, net zero might seem like an ambitious goal, but it's something we should all try doing to help mitigate and adapt to the climate crisis. It also helps take the guilt out of doing mundane things like watching a TV show.
Yeah, for an individual, if you wanted to set your own net zero target, which I think would be incredible, you'd want to reduce your carbon footprint using the three categories I just laid out: what you eat, how you power your home, and how you get around. And then you could buy carbon offsets that retain or remove carbon from the atmosphere. And you can do that through nature, like Netflix is doing currently. You can also invest in more novel and often higher cost projects like direct air capture. But there are tons of ways to find those projects through brokers. And so that's how you could bring your own footprint to zero.
So now that you know what net zero is and how to achieve it, what's your target?